Hello, and welcome to my first ever build guide. I am certainly not a professional at this, as you will probably immediately tell, but I've been playing Lastepoch for the past couple weeks, and I love this game. It's just super, like, all the mechanics are just so well polished that making new builds is so much fun. Everything feels like this new sense of discovery and often surprise, which is really unusual. So I came across this build and basically just wanted to share what I've learned about Infernal Shade for the Necromancer. This isn't really the build I started out expecting to make. I wanted to do something with minions in Infernal Shade, but after finding this path to infinite damage, I mean, I couldn't really pass that up. So this is what it's going to be. So why should you be interested in this build? Well, I assume that you're interested in doing infinite damage, because that's pretty unheard of in any ARPG like this. And when I say infinite damage, what does that really look like? Let me just show you real quick. We're just going to do some of this. And then, yeah, just casting these things a lot over and over, and everything keeps going up. Numbers keep going up. That's what we like to see. So yeah, infinite damage. And this build is also pretty tanky. As you can see, I've got a lot of ward generating over here. Oh! But I lost it. Almost. I didn't. Okay. So you get tons of ward, tons of life, and look, you can move around and still do your damage. Still doing damage. Still doing damage. Still doing damage. It's pretty awesome. So, also, you're doing damage over time. So that kind of gets around a bunch of the annoying mechanics in this game. Not annoying, but challenges. Like, you don't have to worry about crit avoidance in your targets and or dodge chance or things like that. And you also bypass armor. So that's pretty handy. The build requires minimal gear requirements. So really, you can do this almost out of the box once you get high enough level. There's just a couple things that make your life a lot easier, and then everything after that is adding on damage. On the downsides, as you saw, there is some buildup, so that can be annoying depending on your preferences. It's not terrible, but it is there, especially to get to the highest levels of damage. And there's a lot of micromanagement, as you saw. It's hard to talk and also build up your combo. So if that's not your thing, then this probably isn't the build for you. And when you're doing off-screen damage, that also means off-screen loot. So there's a chance of missing out on drops and things like that, which is unfortunate. But I think it's a ton of fun to play. So let's get into how we actually do this thing. So first of all, let's look at what we've done with Infernal Shade. So one thing that's amazing about Infernal Shade is that, well, if you think about increases to damage, there's either additive increased or multiplicative more damage. And every node in Infernal Shade is a more damage. They're all multiplied together. So the real key things are, so we have a bit of increased duration. That's really just to balance out this more damage with reduced duration. We want this shifting doom. That chance to reattach means that when your target dies, yeah, you move to a new target. That's essential because we're building up big infernal shades. We don't want to lose our investment of them. More max shades is also very good because they will end up buffing each other. More damage, always good. And so to counteract that radius problem, we have increased radius on this side, and then more radius and another more damage. Blaze Shade, this is kind of optional. It's nice when it happens because of that 200% area effect. And again, more damage, but it's a chance thing. So it's just when it happens, it's fun. This one is kind of a trap because of that 60% duration hit. It does not combine with wildfires, because if you have both of these, you end up having zero duration and your shade just disappears instantly. So don't do that. And I prefer the guaranteed 90% personally, but you could try it and do different things. Legion is really nice. It lets you put up more shades at once, but in this build, it's not really necessary, and I didn't really want the extra mana cost. And again, you don't want to accidentally overwrite your shades for this build. We don't really need the mana efficiency. As you can see, we're already down to 7 mana. These slows are really nice, but I don't really have the points for it right now. This kills your shade and doesn't matter. This explodes your shade at the end, but our damage increases don't apply to it, so there's no point. Waiting on the ground, actually kind of cool because of this fire penetration per second, but that requires just standing around and waiting for somebody and luring them in, so no worries about these two. Minion side, we are not a minion build, but the minion build is really cool, and I encourage you to play around with it because of this node, right, these two nodes right here, really, this where it grows in damage multiplicatively every second and then lasts forever. Very interesting, but not what we're doing here. Up here, we've got Ignite and fire penetration for Ignite. Also, these are really nice in general for when you haven't ramped up. But at this point, we're already going to be doing too much damage. And again, the Ignite damage isn't modified by our damage boost. So no point to go up here. And then that's just going into converting to physical, which there's, again, no point to do here, especially with the armor shred, because that's we're not doing damage that's affected by armor. Okay, so we've got more damage, more damage, more damage, more area, reattach. So that's good, but then how do we make it even better? Let's go into sacrifice. Key node in sacrifice is right here. So if you cast sacrifice with at least one minion, all of your infernal shades go down to 2 second duration, but do more damage. This is, I believe this is an increased damage. Yeah, it's increased, it's not multiplied. But this is basically giving you 250% increased damage to your Infernal Shade for free. The way that the remaining duration works is that no matter, so when you cast your Infernal Shade, it has its remaining duration. It could be like 5 seconds, it could be unlimited if you cast it on a minion. That value basically gets replaced with 2 seconds. But it doesn't change its current time remaining, it's just the maximum time remaining. And the current, if the current is greater than the maximum. So, you have a 2 second duration, but the first time you cast this, but if you cast it again, well, you still have a 2 second duration, but now you have a 500% increased damage. If you cast it again, you still have a 2 second duration, but you have 750% increased damage. And so on and so on. So this is fundamentally how our shade grows in damage over time. Mana efficiency, fantastic. And a global increased damage, also fantastic. Just, again, multiplicative, but not key because it requires, we want to put our shade out first and then sacrifice. So it's fine, even at least for the mana efficiency. These don't matter really, just getting up to here, and then going the other way, increased area is fine, but what really matters is over here where we're chaining targets. So we pay a mild increased mana cost, and we can chain sacrifices. So what this is really doing is this is giving us kind of time and mana for free. Because now with one cast of sacrifice, we get up to 3 sacrifices, or up to 8 sacrifices with this fully invested. So, and then on the time side, we have to do one cast and we get 8 copies of it. I think that makes sense. And then these area nodes just help us out with the chaining, because the chaining will only take to other minions in the area of sacrifice. So what this means is that if I have 8 minions out, all in an area together, and I cast sacrifice once, I now get a 2,000% damage bonus to shade, to Infernal Shade, and still 2 seconds of duration. I didn't go in these other areas. This one is cool because of the damage over time boost, but has the same limitations of Infernal Vindiction. But increased mana cost, I did not want to incur that. Blood Spectres seem cool. Maybe I'll try them at some point. But again, increased mana cost without a significant investment over here, and more increased mana costs. And this is just increasing the sacrifice damage, so I don't really care about that, because the sacrifice isn't. Sacrifice does do a significant amount of damage, relatively, but not compared to the Infernal Shade. So we now have our Infernal Shade with a bunch of damage multipliers that's now getting thousands and thousands of increased damage, but it's only lasting for 2 seconds. So what do we do about that? Aha! We go over and look at Dread Shade. And this is why this build has to be a Necromancer, because we need access to Dreadshade, which is not available for Liches right now. And Dreadshade has this one little node right over here that says refresh the duration on Infernal Shade when Dreadshade is cast. So if you cast Sacrifice, you have 2 seconds remaining. 1 second later, you cast Dreadshade, and you go back to 2 seconds remaining on all of your Infernal Shades. And repeat forever, infinitely, and get loot. other important things about Dreadshade. Well, there's this little one pointer right here that says 25 armor per vitality. That is going to come into play later. As you might know, we have tons of vitality nodes in our passives, and it's already great to stack vitality for just survivability later in higher corruption. So yeah, this isn't a kind of incredible node, except that you decay health faster. That's sad, but we'll look at that in a second. So yeah, for 1 point, 25 more armor per vitality. Fantastic. But how do we get access into that? Well, we go down here and Symbiotic Apparition. We are affected by our aura now. So we now get access to our armor boost. That's really the secondary effect of the Dreadshade, is to just buff ourselves. But we have lots of increased health decay. If you cast Dreadshade, it kills your minions pretty quickly. So what do we do to mitigate that a bit? We go over here and we look at Pernicious Pact. So this takes away health decay and applies Everlasting Poison. And seriously, this is like night and day, where before your minions last for like 7 seconds, maybe, even with reduced decay, and now they can just stick around, because every second they're taking like 1 damage, then 2 damage, then 3, then 5. And they've got like 5,000 hit points, I don't know, more. So it doesn't scale. The point is it's scaling linear damage. It's still growing, but it's not multiplicative based on their health decay. Fantastic. Unfortunately, you do have to take this note on the way, which turns Dreadshade into a poison skill instead of necrotic. That's sad, because we'd really prefer Dreadshade to be necrotic. But going this way is a no-go, because it takes away your aura buffs and gives it an 18-second cooldown. Over here, Spectral Distance, this inverts the area of Dreadshade. So you get so everyone who's outside of the area gets affected by it. This is a playstyle thing. If you want to stick around your minions or whoever you're casting it on at all times, if you find that easier, then just drop this. And if you drop it, then you can invest in these other area nodes. But I find it easier that even if I'm inside of one area of my one Dreadshade, I'll usually have multiple Dreadshades, and so I'll be outside of a different Dreadshade. Also worth noting, when we convert to Everlasting Poison, this eliminates all the health decay bonuses. It's pretty fantastic. Other good stuff in here, cast speed, always useful. Mana efficiency, well, we're 9 mana, we don't really need any more. And so, last thing over here, every 3% health missing, we get 3% increased buffs. So what's fantastic is that as your minion affected by Dreadshade starts losing health to its poison or whatever, that armor buff that you're getting is going to be increased. Sadly, the necrotic damage actually would be really cool to have with Infernal Shade, but we lose that because of the poison conversion. But we still get to buff the armor, and technically the poison, but who cares? Okay, so this is the engine, essentially, is that we have Infernal Shade, we are pumping it up with Sacrifice, and then keeping it around with Dreadshade. So who are we actually sacrificing? Well, let's go over to skeletons. Skeletons are our minion of choice to sacrifice, and there are many reasons for this. First of all, mana efficiency, 80%. That's a lot. That's fantastic. Ward when your skeletons die. Well, they're going to be dying constantly, so also fantastic. Mind catcher. So 15 mana when they die. This is kind of what completes the loop with sacrifice, is that sacrificing our skeletons returns all the mana that we needed, so we basically don't care about mana regeneration for the most part. Memory Catcher up here is kind of cool because it's a spell damage, another 100% increased damage buff. That's going to get totally obliterated by Sacrifice's boost, but it's nice for just walking around if you aren't using Sacrifice a lot, if you don't have a boss to wear down. More importantly, though, is Immortal, because this means whenever your skeletons die, they have a chance to pop back. And so that can save us some mana. It's just a little convenience. Going the other direction, okay, this is essential because summoning one skeleton at a time is a huge pain. What we really want to do is get as many skeletons as possible. So I would put infinite points in this if I could. But this gives us 3 skeletons per cast. That's pretty good. Notice that I didn't take this extra skeleton. I went this way instead. And that was because I want to remove archers. Now, remember that I said with sacrifice, it triggers off everything in the same area. It chains to other minions in the same area, rather. So we would really want all of our minions to be in the same place when we cast sacrifice. And removing the archers helps us with that. So I have one bonus here. Skeletons start at 3, you get +1 as a necromancer, so we're at 5. I'm going to end up at 6 total. You could go higher, but 6 is the limit to what you can cast in 2 summons. So I don't find a lot of benefit to going higher than that. You could to account for the immortality, but this is where I'm at right now, and I find it works for me. In the end, I might redistribute actually some points out of immortal, but it's just a nice backup to help get more skeletons out. So yeah, this is all buffing the skeletons, the warriors, which is great, but not what we need to do because they're just fodder for our sacrifices. We don't need rogues and we don't care about archers. So that's the skeleton. And finally, we have wraiths. The reason that we have wraiths will come up a bit more when we get into the gear. Let me tell you that they are important. They help a lot. And how we specialize them is similar to skeletons. We go over this way. This lets us target. That's great. Text we don't care about. But here we now summon 3 per cast. And here we go to 4 per cast. And then we reduce the cooldown speed because this does add a cooldown to us. I stopped at 4 for a similar reason as the skeletons, and that's when we go over here, we have +2 max wraiths. This gives us a cap of 8. So with 2 casts, we can hit that cap of 8. We could go more here so that in a single cast we get to 6, but that's just increasing our overall mana. And we want to be at 8 wraiths, and so I don't really want to cast this twice for even more mana and waste 4 of them when I'm building up wraiths. So stop at 4, but 8 max. Going this way, this is nice. It hurts the mana cost a bit and slows them, but 40% multiplicative health is fantastic. And then everything into delaying the end, keeping our wraiths around as long as we can by reducing their health decay. That really doesn't matter. We're not doing crits. And this is great. I'd put more points in here if I could to get that mana efficiency down. Because right now you can see it's cost 60. I have 130 mana. So that's really fairly taxing. The only thing to consider with wraiths synergize well with the warriors and skeletons because they're both going into melee, so they're all going to be grouped up to be sacrificed together. We don't really want to convert these into ranged wraiths or anything like that. They more health would be great because they would last, you know, a fraction of a second more, but because health decay is based per max health, it's not essential. Not decaying would be awesome, but there's no need to have static wraiths because they're being sacrificed constantly, and more is very, very good for this build. So that's really why we're going this way for wraiths. Also, we go the bottom route instead of the top because it saves us a skill point. Well, yeah, it saves us a skill point to do that because 1-2 versus 1-2, and then we needed to get this anyway. So, okay. That's the Wraith tree, and that's all the specializations for our skills. I will say that when we are playing, so my skill bar pretty much always looks like this, but I sometimes will switch up Transplant for the Wraith, and so I can teleport around. But we'll get to that more when we get to equipment. So, next, let us talk about our passives. Another deep dive into passives. Okay. So, starting with our base, Acolyte, we go all in on Forbidden Knowledge. It's a great node. We get intelligence that helps out the ward retention that you were seeing for the tankiness. It helps out the damage of Infernal Shade. Gives us necrotic resistance. I love free resists. The only competitor here is Bone Aura. Extra armor is okay, but like you saw, you're getting 25 armor per vitality from the Dread Shade. So flat armor isn't the highest priority. Next tier, vitality. Yay, I like it. Here's where we're adding, another 200 points of armor to our Dreadshade. It's adding hit points to ourselves and also giving our minions some health. That's good for them. This thing is totally not worth investing in because of the 10% chance to gain ward, but we need it to get over here for even more ward retention and more free resists, which again, I love. Everything else in here, these are increased damages. So in general, I'm not looking for any increased damage because sacrifice is adding so much increased damage that it just totally eclipses anything I can get from passives or even gear in some cases. So skip those. Cast speed when we cast a minion skill is actually really nice. But so if you don't have all that in your gear, this is a, Dark Rituals is a great node to take because we're always casting skeletons, so it's pretty likely that it will be in be up. Revenants don't care. Maybe it's neat, but it's one. Don't care. More resists. This would be fine, but I just found better places for the points later on. This, we don't care about damned, don't care about damage. Minions don't need more health, they're on their own. And again, this would be a fine thing if we had points in Dark Rituals. I don't mind giving my minions more armor, but not a priority. They often do not have a long lifespan. Okay, let's go look at what's in Necromancer. So starting out, you have a choice between minion buffing, self buffing. We go for self. Also, so the increased cast speed is actually kind of cool when you use a potion, and I'm not gonna say no to 25 hit points. Minion buffing. And ward retention and gain on death. No 10% chance, just every time a minion dies. I like that. Both of those will be very useful to us since our skeletons are dying in mass. So this is a playstyle choice. I like it though. It turns your potion into a total emergency button, and gives, because your minions end up with a lot of life, like thousands of life. So, taking all of it and healing yourself sounds good to me. The killing a minion is a little unfortunate because, as you saw, I was sacrificing life also. So sometimes I'll walk over a potion and just accidentally kill a minion. Sorry, guy, but it's worth it, and they always come back. This is a nice node just to get extra minion health, but not enough points. I have to put myself first. Armor shred, we're doing damage over time, so not important to us. This is okay. Ward equal to the mana cost of summon skeletons or wraiths, but the amount of ward really doesn't pay off, right? Because because here we're generating what, 105 per skeleton cast, essentially, because we have three skeletons who are fated to die soon, and that's a lot more than 24 that this would give us. So, no to you. Amazing. Amazing passive. When a minion dies, you mark for death the nearest enemy. That's just so good in every circumstance. You want to mark everything for death, so this will make you very happy. Extra skeleton. We don't need to get to this one because we got this one up here, and like this one brings us to six, so we can skip that. Minion damage, don't need it. This, so I'm fairly new to playing with Life Drinker, but I decided that I didn't really need the, it wasn't worth the 5 points to get up to 500 ward for just when I drink a potion. That didn't seem worth it to me. But I'm still experimenting a bit with the final kind of few points in this build, so it's worth a try, and especially as in higher corruption. But I haven't needed it up to 300 or so yet. Skeleton Vanguards, so this is one of those trials for me. There's two ways to there's multiple ways to generate Vanguards, but this is a nice way in the passives because it's when your minions die, so you don't rely on a swarm to wipe out to generate Vanguards. And they're melee, so they go right in with the Wraiths and the Skeletons. Okay, this is actually fantastic, and I totally overlooked this node, but 20% cast speed, get it. Like, it's always going to be good, especially before you have good gear. Minion damage. So this is actually interesting and might compete with Life Drinker. This is an automatic sacrifice of your minion to heal yourself. So if you don't have time to react, basically, it could save you. But it's a 25% chance, so I took the guarantee and just hope that I'm fast enough with my reflexes. We'll see. Yeah, your minions can die, so take their health, take it for yourself. Totally not necessary unless you do not have gear yet. As if you do not have resist blessings or gear, this you might want to take 3 points so you can go up to right of undeath, because that's a lot of resistances per point, and it is useful. More vitality, fantastic. Resistances for minions, good for them. This is crit stuff up here, we don't care about. This is really nice because of the number of minions. I might try this out just for the extra armor. Don't use mages. We don't really want to pay another 5% of our health every time we cast a spell. So that is this tree. Let's look over at Lich. Lich is a great tree, especially the bottom half of it. I mean, the top half is great too, don't get me wrong. But with more health and spell damage leached, excuse me, as health. This is fantastic because if you're doing infinite damage, 4% of infinite is infinite. So you're going to do a lot of damage and you want to leech that. That's going to be one of our sustain methods. Intelligence, always fantastic. Mana regen helps us with those double Wraith summons, for example. So definitely no bad thing to say about that. We don't need increased damage, so skip it. Again, this is a trial thing. This is way less important. I was just like, I have 2 points, I gotta put them somewhere. So let's make more vanguards, more bodies to sacrifice to get to that 8 chain. Minion boost. We're not doing much necrotic. Increased damage, don't care about it. One time ward, that's not a good payoff. These are bad nodes, don't do them. Don't do this. We want our health leech. It keeps us alive, and we don't care about increased damage. Increased damage, it's fine if you just want, if you wanted every single point of damage you could do, you could totally trade some survivability and take nodes like this, but that's not what I'm doing. More vitality. This I'm actually interested in. I might, just for that extra 10, just for that extra, half second or whatever, especially on bosses, this might be worthwhile, just having an auto kill. But if you're going to get it, don't get it unless you can go all the way to 5. More mana. This was just because of that double Wraith summon at 60 mana. I just wanted to make sure that I had enough. And then extra ward retention, that is never a bad thing. Don't need it. And 16 intelligence. I love this node. 2 intelligence per point. Get it. More ward retention. More damage, more minion health. And that's it. That's the passives. Like, that's the basic build. Stack your intelligence, stack your vitality, get resists if you need them, some life steal, and then whatever else you need to survive. Okay. So, what comes after passives? Let's look at Okay, let's put this together. So, what are we really, what does it look like in practice to do our little combo here? We put out Infernal Shade. We don't want to do that. What we want to do is put out Dread Shades first, and now put out an Infernal Shade. And we do a lot more damage. Even if it's a little one, we do a lot more damage. Once we, that's just basic, getting our Infernal Shade out with more damage. We like to have Dread Shades equipped. Once we have an Infernal Shade out, we sacrifice it, and now we do a lot more damage. Very good. So, we Dread Shade, Infernal Shade, sacrifice, bring back minion, Dread Shade, Dread Shade. Sacrifice, bring back minions, Dread Shade. Sacrifice, bring back minions, Dread Shade. And do this for the rest of your life. So we can also, we can speed this up a little bit. We can Infernal Shade, sacrifice, minion, Dread Shade, sacrifice, minion, Dread Shade. Because we have enough cast speed. If you don't have enough cast speed, you might struggle with this. If you don't have enough cast speed, you might want to take points out of sacrifice so you're not chaining to everybody. Just sacrifice three at a time. That's fine. And then you would sacrifice Dread Shade, minion, Dread Shade, sacrifice, Dread Shade, minions, Dread Shade. And go like that. You don't have to rush to the end. That's an optimization thing. And practice this too. Come here, look at the training dummies, just practice. Two minions, two minions, two minions. And just work on maintaining the rhythm and keeping your mana up, but also keeping that Infernal Shade up and growing. In practice, you do not have to do this very often. In right now, I'm at corruption 300. One or two sacrifice rounds kills almost everything. But practice on the dummy because it is important for bosses, and once you get up to higher corruption levels, it's gonna become more and more important. I have no idea how far this can go, but I'm eventually gonna find out. So that's the basic technique of how we're doing things, and I'll give you a live demo in a little bit. But first, I want to talk about gear. Okay, I said you don't need a lot of gear for this build. Totally true. I would say none of these uniques are really required. This Lich's Envy, not required, but for all practical purposes, it's required. Like, it's really the minus 10, the mana cost reduction for Infernal Shade and Dread Shade. It just makes life so much easier once those have their mana costs cut down. The spell damage for damage over time spells, great. Now, this is why I was casting Dread Shade first, is that you have 19 spell damage for Infernal Shade for each active Dread Shade. So we have six max shades right now. We have plus one from four base, plus one from Dread Shade, plus one from Infernal Shade Mastery. So this is another reason why I didn't go beyond six minions, because we do our six Infernal sh or six Dread Shades, and now this is max damage. You could go get the second piece of the set and have four more max shades, but that's only going to be, I mean, it's going to be what, a 66% total damage increase, and that would also mean you need to have 10 minions out. It's just six works really well right now. Maybe that would be a necessity at higher, corruptions, but right now, it's not going to be for a long time. You also get more area for each Dread Shade, so that's good. You always want to have like a couple Dread Shades. I would like two or three is really fine. because that's giving you enough base damage and area to keep your Infernal Shade active. It's just when you're going into like a boss fight that you want to really maximize that damage. So yeah, Lich's Envy, very important, kind of annoying to get, just because it is, you have to kill that Fire Lich, and if you don't know, it is, what is it? Soulfire Bastion, sorry. Soulfire Bastion, it's a rare drop, 15-ish percent, tier 3, tier 4, of Soulfire Bastion. So, but once you get it, that really makes this build wonderful. And it gets better. We can go up to the very familiar Ghostmaker. I've seen many people using Ghostmaker. I haven't seen anyone using Ghostmaker for this purpose, though, despite the fact that seems to be what Ghostmaker was built for. 38 spell damage base, 40 max, extra necrotic damage, that's good. It does unfortunately split our damage type to fire and necrotic for Infernal Shade. Chance to summon Wraith, this is great, and when you kill an enemy, this is great because you get free Wraiths, obviously. Also, when it's cast, it uses your specialization. So if you have summon Wraith summoning 6 Wraiths, you get 6 Wraiths on 15% chance on kill. It's really nice, but it means that if you're doing Monoliths, you will usually have Wraiths up. Now, the casting Infernal Shade when you kill an enemy, that is actually kind of undesirable because you don't really want to overwrite any Infernal Shade that you've buffed with Sacrifice. But it is a necessary evil because of the next line, which is 66% more damage per Wraith. So now we're taking our Wraiths and we're turning 8 Wraiths into an almost 500% multiplier. More damage. This is a 5x multiplier to Infernal Shade that already has a bunch of multipliers. That's already getting 2,000% damage per sacrifice cast. That means 10,000% just from Ghostmaker when you have 8 Wraiths out. This is incredible. Bosses die faster than uncommons with like the ox with increased health. It's insane. I love it so much. And then increased area. Sure, that's great. Happy to have it. Just a flat increase. This is fantastic, and I would highly recommend getting one. They're a common drop. Just get it. Also in that line, Twisted Heart, fantastic. Every time you cast an elemental or a necrotic spell, you convert your max health into ward. Also +1 to necrotic and elemental spells. Elemental spell, elemental spell. These two are what's generating ward for me, and also happy to have the +1. Extra strength means extra armor, that's great. Extra cast speed, extra health. All these things are fantastic. If you don't have it, Ambitions of Erased Acolyte is a perfectly acceptable substitution. But go for this once you're comfortable and have some gear and some more DPS. Ribbons of Blood. Honestly, I made this earlier and just happened to have the critical strike avoidance. Don't care about the health regeneration. That's too bad. But extra increased health is fantastic, and also the crit avoidance for the minions it's nice, just to make sure that they don't instantly die. Not essential, though, but nice thing to have. Rotmind, I'm a big fan of this. Intelligence is great. Crit strike doesn't matter. But more base damage over time It's poison, but still, base damage is always appreciated, and it is multiplied by sacrifice, plus another plus one to skills and damage reduction. These things are all very good. And you're getting that extra poison damage, is you're getting 1% of it back. So, you know, that's fine. And more increased area. Very happy with Rotmind. If you do not have Ghostmaker and Rotmind, consider the Synathia's Resurrection. This is a more defensive take, but it also gives critical strike avoidance, more health to your minions, helps them survive, and it's another 20% up to 20. Is it up to 20%? Yeah, up to 20% chance for your skeletons to come back. So, even more resurrection, you could. If I was using this, I would then definitely up my max skeletons. Unfortunately, Infernal Shade is not a curse, though. And as a main hand, the Firestarter's Torch is pretty nice, actually, because Sacrifice does trigger the Spreading Flames proc, but that gives another up to 50% damage multiplier. Also, the -4 spell mana cost for your Infernal Shade and Sacrifice is not bad at all. Bleeding Heart, great, I love it. More damage leeched, I'll take it. Alternatives are Confluence of Fate, because of the three different flat spell damage boosts. But this is very aggressive to give up your, because this is really one of your biggest source of spell life leech. So to give that up and then take more damage, it's your call. everything else, there aren't great uniques to go here. There are good ones, and if you find them with legendary potential, go for it. Prismatic Gaze, you can absolutely use it. You can use your lower cost spells and then summon Wraith and shatter your prisms and shred their fire resistance. That's cool. If you have it, but I wouldn't give up survivability for it. Woven Flesh, fantastic. Tons of armor, more health, more critical strike avoidance, more leeching. Very, very good if you can get it with legendary potential, which obviously I did not. I want to love this. I want to use this so much because of this fire spell, base fire damage, base spell damage rather, for fire and necrotic skills per stack of ignite. But getting stacks of ignite is not easy. Even at 100%, you have to be spamming fire spells constantly, which we're not really. We're casting them regularly, but we're not spamming them. And even then, getting up to 40 stacks, not going to happen. This would help in theory with the self-igniting, self-immolating, and more penetration, but I'm not going to sacrifice my Ghostmaker. Just pointing it out, if you want to try igniting yourself a lot, also get this Hubris. And go into, what's that skill? Spirit Plague. Spirit Plague, make yourself bleed, and then this turns it all into ignite stacks. Worth trying, maybe someday, but it's not gonna, 240 base damage. I don't think that's gonna max the 5x of the more damage from Infernal Shades, but it could be fun. I do love the 100% chance to cleanse all ailments. That is very useful. So I might play around with this sometime. And then you have another offhand that gives you 100% armor when you're ignited and does some more damage also, a few small multipliers. So potential, but certainly more complicated. Also, if you happen to have an Omnis, I mean, if you have more skill points to put into Infernal Shade, there's still this more damage to tap into, or this slowing. Both are good. For the rest of my gear, These are just crafted. They're not great. This filling up resistances. I typically focus on vitality first. For multipliers, I look for more armor first because of that huge base armor from Dreadshade, and then just look for ways to stack health. If you have extra damage, eventually optimized, I will want to get more damage over time. Elemental is good, and so is just plain damage over time because of the necrotic base. Move speed is good because we're not using any movement skills, and otherwise it's really just health and enough critical avoidance to not be crit. You can try just about any of the Acolyte's armor pieces for the helm and the body armor. I like this one because of the extra damage leeched. I was thinking about area for helm, but that will increase your dreadshade area, which you don't really want to. So I really shouldn't have done this for area for skills on this bleeding heart. But such is life. So yeah, really just craft stuff for survivability and use that as a starting point, grow the rest of your gear. This still has +2 to rip blood. Like, that's ridiculous. I guess the 46% spell damage is nice, but this is just stuff that I've put together. Freeze rate multiplier, who cares? For idols, there are really no idols. None of the Acolyte specific ones matter. I would not, like I said, convert my wraiths. I would just keep it the way it is, just keep them melee as they are. So just use your idols to fill out your resistances and to pick up more vitality. Because remember, this is, read this as +2 vitality, plus 50 armor. +3 vitality, plus 75 armor. And then take extra armor when you can. And yeah, my resists are not maxed. They're not completely full, but I have been able to do 300 corruption without any trouble, just because of how tanky this is. Blessings. Black Sun, we want health leech, more health leech. This might not be that important. You could try something else here, just because of the innate 4% and the if you have a bleeding heart, this becomes less relevant. Some resist, lightning resist, just because. This with my ring gets me to 100%. That's pretty standard. And then base armor and increased armor. Increased armor, very good because of the, again, dreadshade. And you don't want to be 100% reliant on the dreadshade, so do take, like, I do prefer equipment and things with higher base armor. And this doesn't matter at all. For farming, I went for extra uniques. Dagger, that's the only weapon you care about right now. It's just trying to get a Ghost Maker with some legendary potential. And for relics, I'm trying to get the Twisted Heart with LP right now, so I'm doing relics. Change it to gloves when you need gloves, offhand if you want to go farm for a nice rot mind, which is very easy, so that's probably not a high priority. But yeah, switching between these two, farming good ones for these is probably what you're going to be looking at there. Well, that's really gear. Oh, I didn't talk about loot filters. I will paste this, of course, but the way that I do loot filters is I like to, so I always have one dedicated to just all the idols with the few things that I care about, which is mostly just health and armor. And keep those emphasized. Then I like to do one per equip slot. So here, because I already have my Ghostmaker, I only care about Exalteds. And the main thing for your dagger is cast speed. That's number one. Number two is damage over time. And then a chance to chill and slow. Just extra whatever ailments suit you, but these two seemed to be the most important to me, if you can find them, as if I'm ever going to get an LP4 Ghostmaker. But that's what I look for, basically. Catalyst, very similar, just looking for things to add to Rotmind. This is going to be chill and slow when I'm hit on attackers. Damage over time, cast speed. And I'll just put this out there if you want to look through it yourself, but that's the way I have all these set up. For some, so like, I don't have rings that are perfect, so I just have a mix of mostly health, of the same health bonuses. And having a couple modifiers with minion health is worthwhile. So like right now I have almost 400% minion health, just to, because you don't want them to die too much, especially since you're stealing a quarter of their life. So if you, for items I haven't gotten exalted yet, I care more about that aren't uniques. All of these are good. Silver ring would be the most aggressive if you want to farm monoliths. Otherwise, these are both nice. Or filling in your missing resistances is also an option. Amulet, very similar. If it's exalted, haha, you don't care what kind of amulet it is. So that was my mistake there. The only thing to point out in relics. Relics do have the level Infernal Shade, so that's amazing if you can get it, but Infernal Shade really does okay without additional points in it. It'll be okay. For helms, body armor, we just want increased health, increased armor, and then minion health if we need to, and that's it. Like that's what we're looking for. Prioritize your defensive stats over your increased damage. I also switched to exalted often when I already have an exalted, because then it's like I want at least one of these to be a tier 6 or 7. And then boots, like I said, movement speed. And then defensive stats. I also like to have a crafting shard thing that I set to blue because I almost never look at magic items. So I just turn my crafting, things I need for crafting shards, just update this with whatever affixes you're kind of low on and I want to pick up, want to be aware of to break down. I always look at these, and I always hide these, and that's my filter. Okay, let's go real quick and look at some real-world applications now that we're getting into hour number two of this guide. Let's just go over here. I'm going to do one boss and one monolith, just to kind of show you what I do. And because I'm recording this, I'm probably going to make mistakes and it'll be a huge disaster, but we'll see what happens. And you can listen to my phone, my fan in the background as I load. Let's go fight you. Okay. Ah. Too fast. And I'm gonna redo this because I want to show you how to actually set up. But this guy got two ahead of the game. That is not how I usually do those fights. Okay, we're gonna stand in this corner. We're gonna stand in that corner. Good job, guys. Okay, so before we start the fight, I want to have six dread shades and summon Wraith out, my max Wraiths. Then I'm going to go in and then I'm going to cast Infernal Shade, then I'll back off and just focus on keeping it up. So here's what I do. And there, and there. I think it got overwritten when he summoned the minions. But he died eventually. Cool. So that's basically how boss fights go. But he lasted longer because he had minions, and that's what I was saying with this chance to cast Infernal Shade when when we kill an enemy. That's what happened there. Hey, it has LP, sure, I'll take it. And I need more Soulfire Bastion keys. Why not? And I'll take that too, I suppose. But that's the general idea, is set up your Dread Shades, set up your Wraiths, put out Infernal Shade, and blow them up. Now let's look at a. So one thing I like about this build a lot is that, as you can see, like he had increased damage and health. But I really don't care about most modifiers in general. Things that do like actually increased physical damage or elemental damage, I'm a little wary of those modifiers, but I'll do them. But everything else, like glancing blow doesn't affect me. Deadly doesn't affect me. I mean, sorry, deadly does affect me, but I'm casting out damage so fast, it doesn't matter as much. Most of these, I just don't care. Like dodge, crit avoidance, just go after the nodes that you care about. Okay, let us do a monolith. So when I'm doing monoliths, like I said, I start out with two or three of the dread shades and liches, run around, put out more dread shades just to renew the duration. Maybe I'll blow them up if I feel like it. Just glance over there at the active dread shades to keep that up. But as you can see, I'm kind of running ahead of everybody. I didn't really need to do that, but I did because I'm recording it. So this is why I don't want to try and stay, why I inverted the area is what I was trying to say, is that the minions tend to fall behind. I don't want to wait for them. So I use the inverted aura. And what's nice is you can cast Dread Shade basically anywhere. And you can cast Infernal Shade basically anywhere. And they will just find their target. Do. But if I cast it and notice that the number didn't go up, then maybe I'll just move my mouse around a little bit. I don't know if you caught that, but that was the difference between having shades out and not having shades out, killing a boss. Or, yeah, not a boss, but a rare enemy. Always watching the mini-map, just in case a unique drops or something. And he dies fast because of Ghostmaker. And that's it. That is the build. That's how it works. I hope that was interesting to you. I, like I said, really loved making this build and exploring it. I'm very grateful for the Last Epoch developers for making it. And I thank you for taking the time to look through this and pay attention to the parts that you did. I am also linked on, this build will be up on Last Epoch Tools. I go by Hineroptera. I'll put that in the comments, or in the description. In the game, feel free to send me a message with any feedback or leave a comment here. I'm interested to hear what you have, if you have any thoughts, things that I did poorly or things that I did well. Other things you want to see, or suggestions or questions about the build. I love talking about just the mechanics and builds in general, so I'm happy to talk about it if you have any questions. Yeah, thanks again for watching, and good luck. I hope you have fun. Thanks.